It's a really kind of unique topic. It's one that I stumbled upon. And as I got deeper and deeper into it, you know, I had really no idea about this relationship between the Americans, the Doughboys, and the Tommies. And nobody had really explored it in any great detail. So what I'm going to do is kind of give you the quick teaser of the story based on the two divisions, the American 27th and the American 30th, and how they trained and fought with the British Expeditionary Force, starting really in 1917 and 1918. And we'll talk about how well the Brits and the Americans got along. We'll talk about the Dominion troops, the Australians who were also attached to the British, and their relationship with the Americans. We'll talk about the major offensive, which the American, these two divisions spearheaded in September, at the end of September 1918, and then continue on into October. And then we'll talk a little bit about their legacy and allow plenty of time for questions. Okay, so the two divisions that I'm referring to, the first one is the 27th Division. They were, as I said, a National Guard division. They were entirely from New York, so they were very unique in that sense. They had started out, like a lot of the National Guard units on the Mexican border, called up after Pancho Villa's raid by President Wilson. And if you know the backstory, General Pershing, who led the expeditionary force against Villa, wasn't real fond of the National Guard units. He kept them on the border, wouldn't let them cross over into Mexico, so they spent most of their time, you know, battling tarantulas, the heat, all kinds of things, and looking perhaps for a raid. The 27th Division, though, actually went to the border as a full division. They were known as the 6th New York Division, and they actually had a really good stellar record about them, and a lot of that had to do with their commander, who was a guy named John F. Orion, but we'll get to him in a second. They get called up in 1917 after war breaks out, and you probably know the nomenclature of the AEF, but there were certain divisions that were regular army, there were certain divisions that were National Army, meaning the draft troops, and then there were National Guard divisions. So the War Department names the 6th Division the 27th Division. And like all the other National Guard divisions, they had to find a place to train. So they established training mostly in the South, largely because of the climate. You could train all year round. In the case of the 27th Division, they went down to Camp Wadsworth, which is in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And to them, these were New Yorkers. They were from all over the state. You had the Silk Stocking Regiment, wealthy guys from 7th Avenue, but you had farmers from upstate New York around Syracuse area. You had other soldiers who were from the Buffalo area. So this kind of, you know, unique composite groups. And New York has had a fine National Guard militia reputation. And all of a sudden, they were kind of thrown together. And one of the guys in the 27th Division, Private William F. Clark, he wrote his sort of a history of the unit, but more like his memoirs after the war. And he talked about what it was like to train at Camp Wadsworth. He said it was, and this is based on the climate, you know, it's the summer, so he's from upstate New York where it tends to be chillier. He says it was not uncommon to come back from either a day on the drill field or from a 10-mile hike, either perspiring profusely and then almost freeze to death at night. So kind of a typical, and as we talked a little bit about with the postcard presentation, you know, letters and things were censored. So mostly what I found in the letters researching this book was the obvious stuff, talking about missing family, complaining about the uniforms, complaining about training, and complaining about food. It was not until I got into the real diaries that you get the more interesting things about what it was like to serve with the British or serve in combat. Here's the guy that I mentioned, and he's a unique person in his own right. John F. Orion, he was a militia officer. He rose through the ranks. He became friends with Theodore Roosevelt, who we'll hear about later on, and also Leonard Wood. And they took a liking to Orion, in fact, so much that he served, he was able to attend the Army War College in D.C., which is very unique for a National Guard officer. And the main thing that's really unique about Orion is the fact that he commanded the 27th Division throughout the entire war. If you know much about the AEF, especially General Pershing, he was the ultimate micromanager, and he was not afraid to sack officers. He somewhat took a liking to Orion, heard a lot of good things about him, and basically left him alone. Orion, not sure where his military career was going to go, ended up getting a law degree from Columbia University, and he practiced law for quite a while, and after the war he practiced as well. For a short period of time, he was police commissioner of New York, and I think he had his eyes set on becoming the mayor of New York City, and a guy named LaGuardia kind of pushed him out of the way, so that never happened. But he was a strong disciplinarian. He wrote a number of articles and a couple of books on military preparedness, and this job was made for him. In fact, as a young man, he used to go around signing his autograph, Major General John F. Orion. Either that was really egotistical, or he had some kind of prophecy of what was going to happen in the future. Camp Sevier, Greenville, South Carolina, was the home to the other division we're going to talk about today. And they were the 30th Division, more typical of Army National Guard Division during the First World War. And what I mean by that is they were a composite of National Guard units from other states. In this case, three southern states, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Tennessee. They also served on the border, but they were split up. They were brought together. They were nicknamed the Old Hickory after Andrew Jackson. And they were also brought down. And they even recruited troops from other states. So they weren't the true sort of like the 27th Division. They were kind of a mutt in a way of different troops from all over. But they would become very strong and, as we will find out, make their name as well in history. Their commanding officer also was very typical. They had several different general officers who served with the unit. And the Army shuttled and shuffled and just kind of moved these guys back and forth. Finally, when they get over to France, they're commanded by Major General Edward M. Lewis. Lewis had started out in the 2nd Division, commanded one of the brigades there, showed himself to be a good commander. He was also a West Point classmate of Pershing's. So Pershing promoted him to Major General and put him in charge of the 30th Division once they got over to France. The divisions themselves, like the 27th and 30th, and typical of all AEF divisions, trained for about 8 months in the United States, again in the southern U.S. And they were ably assisted by French and British advisors. The American War Department, particularly the General Staff, said, look, we need to get these guys some really good practical experience. So they brought over officers from the BEF and the French Army who had actually participated in campaigns like the Somme and Passchendaele and other fighting, and brought them over to lecture to the doughboys, tell them what it was like to be in the trenches. The main reason was because the officers that the Army had at the time, especially the regular Army officers, their experience was the Western Front of the United States. So they were used to fighting, you know, Native Americans. They had no idea what it was like to fight in the trenches. Orion himself did go over to France for a period toward the trenches, met with some of the British and French officers. So he at least had some inkling of what was going on. But ironically, the British officers who came to train the 27th and 30th Divisions, neither one of those divisions had any idea at the time they were going to end up being attached to the British troops. So after about 8 months, you get into the spring of 1918, and the War Department has got its shipping schedules going. And the backstory is the Americans had no shipping to bring American troops over to France. We had the same problem in the Spanish-American War. We had to take basically whatever we can get. And Pershing was in trouble with this. They, you know, it was kind of typical of the Americans. Hey, let's get into this war, but let's not really prepare for it. So as the British and the French are really clamoring for American troops. I mean, things are into 1917, losses are devastating. The Germans are ramping up for a big offensive in the spring. And who knows, this war could end at any time before the Americans really participate. So Pershing's really got his back to the wall. He's over there in France, and the British are sending envoys over to meet with President Wilson, the Army Chief of Staff, and they say, look, you got to get your guys over here. And the War Department said, well, how? You know, we got to get them over on ships. So the British finally, we get this deep negotiation. The French are pushing for the Americans. The British are pushing. The British basically came up with a better plan. They said, okay, we'll give you some ships. We'll command the ships. But we want your troops to come over, and we want them brigaded entirely with the British Army. Well, President Wilson, in my opinion, was very smart, and he kind of left things up to Pershing. But he said, look, you know, we really don't want, and the American people won't want, our doughboys, our soldiers, our young men fighting entirely under British or French command. Because when it comes time, and this war is going to end eventually, and when it comes time for the Americans to make their mark in the peace talks and how Europe perhaps is going to be split up and really how the world is going to go forward from this, we're not going to have much of a say at the peace table if basically our contribution was under the British or the French. So Pershing sits down with the Chief of Staff of the British Army, and eventually he meets up with Sir Douglas Haig, and they come up with a negotiation. And basically the plan is that the Americans will send over 10 divisions to train with the British. Now, that's a lot of men. The Americans had about, if you look at the tables of organization, a little under 28,000 men per division. The Brits and all the other belligerents had maybe 2/3 of that. So these are really cumbersome divisions. The Brits say, okay, that's all well and fine, but really all we need is your ground troops. We need your infantry. We need your machine gunners. We don't even need your artillery. You can put them elsewhere. So further negotiations go on, and it's decided that, okay, we'll bring over just the infantry, the ground troops, machine gunners, and that kind of support. So in late April, we start sending over 10 divisions. And eventually, by the end of June, they arrive in France. By the way, this is a shot. And also, just I should tell you, all the photographs here, except for a couple at the end, are from the National Archives Signal Corps collection, which, if any of you have not utilized that collection, it's amazing. There's tens of thousands of images that were taken by the U.S. Army, plus there are British photos as well, and they're easy to use, they're well cataloged, and they just document pretty much every aspect of the war. So here's a good shot of Edward M. Lewis, and he looks very typical of an American Army officer, well-dressed, and again, if you know much about Pershing, he had this idea of what the typical Army officer would look like, very sharp, everything, you know, all the lines, everything connected perfectly. Oops. And here's the man himself. This is a little bit later image of Pershing, but I wanted to show it with all his glory, with all his badges and his medals. We could talk about Pershing literally all day. Very somewhat controversial guy. The Brits and the French didn't really care for him. They would prefer to have pushed him aside. But in my opinion, I think he was the best choice for an American commander, largely because of this issue of the so-called amalgamation of the troops, the fact that he was able to negotiate with the British. Some other officer may have cowered and backed down completely. And I think, you know, Wilson gave him full support and let him run the army the way he wanted to. And even though he didn't have the tactical ability that perhaps some of the British and French officers, he was good at organization and he was good at dealing with other people. And this would proved to be invaluable. So here's a typical ship. And it took roughly about 2 weeks to get over to either Great Britain or directly to France. And It was an interesting experience for the Americans. Again, these were British ships. They were supported by American destroyers because there were known German U-boats in the waters. And they left from, the, you know, off of New Jersey. They also left off of Norfolk, Virginia, Newport News, that area. And keeping the men occupied aboard the ships was extremely difficult. Orion, in particular, would have his men go on deck and do calisthenics, make sure they were still keeping up with their training. And the guys in the 27th Division in particular, and even the other eight divisions, didn't know at this point that they were going to be sent to the British sector. But these were British sailors and British crewmen, which meant they had to eat British food. Now, how many people here have been to Great Britain? And you know, I have to say, I like British food, and it's gotten better. But these guys, you know, they're down in South Carolina, and you know, what do you eat in the good old South? You eat a lot of gravy, you eat your biscuits, your fried chicken, and all that stuff. So they're aboard this vessel, and what are they fed? But you know, you got your marmalade, they're fed mutton, all these things that are completely, no pun intended, foreign to them. And they're trying to get used to the food, and they're complaining bitterly. And also, it's very rough on the seas because one of the things that the ships had to do to avoid U-boat attack and kind of throw them off, they went in a zigzag pattern. And keep in mind that most of these Americans, in fact, I would argue to say all of them, probably never had been out on the sea before. Most of them probably hadn't even left their small town in New York or North Carolina or South Carolina or Tennessee. So being out on the ship was rough. And I read one account of a soldier who was talking about the voyage and talking about the food, said that they got four meals a day, two up and two down. So they get over there, and just a couple more images of the types of ships. These were all converted. Many of them were German ocean liners that the Brits had captured and converted into troop transports. So they get over to France, and yes, they were lectured by British and French officers of what it was like to be out on the Somme, what it was like to be in Wipers and Passchendaele, what it was like to be in Verdun. But, and you can watch, you know, film clips, and certainly if you went to the movie theaters, and there were movie theaters in Spartanburg where you could watch newsreels of what was going on overseas on the Western Front. But it wasn't really until, in this case, when the Americans got to Calais, which is in the British sector, and if you've been there, it's right across the channel from Dover, to actually see what it was like, the devastation of war, to see burned-out buildings, rubble in streets. But the one thing that I saw over and over again that really impacted these guys were seeing women, young women, walking around dressed entirely in black, having lost, you know, their sons, their husbands, their brothers, to the war. And typical Americans, when they had some free time, they'd go wandering off and do the typical tourist thing. Well, the Germans knew from various sources and also from flyovers that the Americans were there. And it wasn't unusual for them to fly over and, you know, rattle their machine guns or do something just to show the Americans, hey, you are in the midst of the war. So they get over there, and at this point, they're all kind of brigaded again with the British. And eventually, as the war goes on and more Americans come over, the American units with the British start to shift over to the French sector and eventually into the American sector. And the British are getting really nervous about this. I mean, hey, they made a deal with the Americans. But part of the deal was that General Pershing or other commanders could pull these divisions at any time. And I think the British were under this impression that, hey, that's not going to happen. The responsibility of handling this was under Colonel George S. Simmons. They were known as the U.S. Army Second Corps. And Simmons really had to organize, had to administer, and also take over the duties of dealing with the British officers. He was a career Army officer, had served in the Philippines, and a great administrator. So once they get over, there's a training program set up of 10 weeks where the Americans will learn how to, they already knew the basics of drilling, but they'll learn the basics of warfare, kind of British style. And they turn over their guns, and they're now using the Lee Enfields. And they're being trained by British officers. And eventually this will include going at the line. Well, one of the first things that Simmons has to deal with is the old food issue again. The doughboys, they like to eat. And they were angry about the British food. Well, this is what the British rations are. And again, they're used to larger meals, more abundant meals. And one of the big complaints that Simmons had to deal with was the fact that the British rationed tea instead of coffee. And this was obviously pre-Starbucks. But these guys put up a fight. The poor Simmons had to take away from his regular chores of administrating, getting the training going, to form a committee to look at their actual diet, how many calories they were intaking, and all of that business. And eventually they got to eat American foods, much to the chagrin of the British. So this leads to the question of how well did the Americans and the Brits get along? Well, here's the guy that's probably one of the most famous and controversial commanders, Field Marshal Sir Douglas Haig. And he's the one that really pushed so much for the Americans. And he wrote his wife at one point as the Americans started coming in. He said, "Those we are working with are quite unassuming fellows. Entirely unlike the fashionable Yankees we used to see in London following the wake of some loud-voiced Yankee beauty. Personally, I'm finding the American men connected with the USA forces very much like our own officers. I need give them no higher recommendation." That was what what Haig thought of the typical doughboy. He didn't think so highly of the American officers. And he and Pershing would constantly squabble over the use of the American troops. But the typical situation between the Americans and the British, and this is a nice warm image of them playing nicely in the training area. But by and large, they didn't get along all that well. Countless letters I would read from British officers and enlisted men just complained bitterly about how obnoxious the Americans were. And part of it was the Americans come into this war, they got their nice clean uniforms, and they start bragging to the British, "Hey, you've been in this war for over 3 years, going on 4 years now. What are you doing? Why is this war not over?" "Well, step aside. We're going to take over, and we're going to win this war for you." Well, I mean, you know, that's not going to go over really well. And with one instance I read, a British brigade commander who was leading the Americans into line for the first time wrote that he had to listen to the big talk of what they were going to do, and we had not done yet. And he wrote his family that, "All I hope is that when they, the Americans, do start to fight, Jerry, meaning the Germans, will smash them to atoms, for they are nothing more than human garbage, and this is the best I can say about them." Now, I will say that was one of the most out there quotes that I found, but it was somewhat typical of this animosity. It did get better as they got along and they actually fought in line. Also, training and fighting alongside the Americans were the Australian troops, and they got along far better. There seemed to be this camaraderie between the Australians and the Americans, and I think part of it had to do with the Australians didn't like the British either. They felt they were poorly treated by them, and you know, as Dominion troops, they were looked down upon. Eventually, they would command their own corps, but they would kind of gang up on the British troops, and they really, in a sense, became mentors. One of the Australian troops, for seeing Americans for the first time, remembered how we amused ourselves watching a lot of very brand new looking Yanks arriving with their extraordinary looking equipment. Some of the officers carried leather suitcases and umbrellas and looked more like commercial travelers than soldiers. Sir John Monash, very similar in a way to Orion. He had been a civilian, he was an engineer, he was also very unique being Jewish. He was brought up through the territorial ranks, and he became a consummate soldier, and he, by and large, really admired the American troops. Eventually, as more and more of the American divisions went away and the 27th and 30th remained behind, Pershing appointed a guy by the name of Major General George W. Reed to command the Second Corps. And just a really brief word about what happens at this point. Pershing and Ferdinand Foch are ready to take all the American divisions into the French sector and a now newly formed American sector. Haig is beside himself. He's like, "You're taking all of my divisions." And he complains bitterly to Pershing. They meet in Paris and they have a discussion, and a lot of cool things happen in Paris if you've ever been there. And what happens is Pershing listens to him whine and complain for a long time. Finally says, all right, enough already. You can have two divisions. And Haig had visited the training areas and he got to like the 27th and 30th quite a bit. So he had picked those two divisions, and Pershing said, okay, you can have them. But Pershing was also thinking about, well, this is still only going to be a temporary arrangement. Haig had other ideas. As soon as he got them, and we're talking right now July of 1918, he's got numerous troops that are massed on the Wipers Front around an area called Mount Kemmel, or Kemmel Mountain, whatever, however you want to phrase it. And the Germans are well entrenched in there, and his troops and the Germans have been going at it for a few years now. So as part of this training is to get the Americans acclimated into what it's like to fight into the Western Front. So he comes up to the division commanders, Orion of the 27th and Lewis of the 30th, and says, hey, look, are you guys ready to fight, or are you just going to hang out here? And of course, they say, okay, send us up to the front. So in the end of July into the first part of August, they head up to Ypres. Again, this is an area that's devastated by war, and it just fascinates the Americans. Well, they go into line, and they actually get to fight for the first time on their own with the effort to drive the German troops away. And indeed, that's what happens. And the images here just show the sort of typical scenario that what they encountered. It was a relatively easy operation for the American troops there, largely because the Germans started evacuating. Not so much because they were scared of the Americans, it just was better for them to shift their forces elsewhere on the Western Front. Still, they didn't back down, and there were numerous American casualties, including gas casualties, which was something new also to the American soldiers. They learned how to construct their own billets, as shown in this image. Elsie Janis, does anybody know who she was? She was, in a sense, like the Bob Hope of her day. She used her own money and along with her mom, and there were a number of women like this. She was a stage star in New York, decided that she wanted to do her part for the war effort. So she went over to France and to Belgium and toured throughout the Western Front and entertained the troops. This particular one is of the in the British sector where the 27th and 30th was. And just kind of a very unique story about her. Finally, the American troops were pulled back for more training. And we're talking now into early September. While this is going on, the Allies are formulating a great offensive that's hopefully going to end the war. And by this point, the Americans are attached to British 4th Army under Sir Henry Rawlinson, famous for the Somme. You could say the Somme debacle, but that's for another time. Anyway, he had great admiration for the Americans. And he said, we want them to spearhead this attack. So what he does is he brigades them entirely with the Australian Corps, and they start to train of what it's like to fight in an operation. And their mission is to crack the hardest, the most difficult strength-wise part of the Hindenburg Line, which is connecting the Saint-Quentin canal and this part in the Somme Valley. And they start to train. They train with tanks, and the operation commences on September 27, 1918. And it starts typically as any AEF operation with a preliminary attack. For one thing, there's the on the northern part of the line, you have the 27th Division. They had the most difficult chore. Their goal was to crack two entrenched positions in farms, in Giamont Farm and Kenamont Farm, plus a small rise called the Knoll. The British had tried to crack this for a long period using artillery. It didn't happen. On the 27th, the 27th of September, the 27th jumps off, and they take severe casualties. Particularly, the 106th Infantry gets decimated. They're followed by the 107th. Further south is the 30th Division. They have a little bit easier time. And part of it had to do with the British artillery was able to soften the line south as opposed to north, and the poor 27th guys got beat up. In the meantime, more and more supplies and troops are heading to the rear, and you can see from this image just the congestion of going through these French villages. Part of the battle, laying the wire, which proved to be troublesome because the Germans knew about this and they would aim their artillery to break up the line. So mostly you had to deal with runners, a very dangerous position of going back and forth between the front trenches and the rear trenches. The British artillery, numerous books have been written on it, probably the best around, although the French might argue a little bit differently, but they had a very difficult time cracking the tough German lines. And part of it was the fact that here's the canal. Has anybody been to Bonny in the Saint-Quentin? So you know it's still there. You can still walk through it. This is one of the passageways. And the Germans basically lived in here. They used communication and very, very difficult. And as the attack commenced, the Germans come out. Australian troops leading tanks up to the front. Well, as the battle, the preliminary operation doesn't go all that well. Some of Orion's troops are caught in the middle of the line. There's talk about shifting the artillery, shifting the lines in order not to kill the Americans. That's done to a degree, but the main jump off happens on September 29 in the early morning 1918. And the Americans leap forward. One commander said it sounded like popcorn popping with all the machine guns going, all the bullets whizzing, and General Edward M. Lewis referred to it as a cacophony of sounds, just deafening noise. Compasses were used, not very effectively. It was rainy, it was misty, it was foggy that morning. Eventually, the Americans make it ahead. There's a lot of confusion. There's spotter planes, and word comes back from the American front that, hey, we've cracked the line. We've cracked part of the Hindenburg line that we wanted. Later on, it's determined that wasn't entirely the case because the Germans get, when they start to regroup and they push the Americans back. And by the end of the day, they have moved forward, but there's a significant amount of casualties. In the meantime, though, a lot of the German troops themselves had had enough of the war, and they're starting to surrender on their own. And typical images of this and German troops yelling, comrade, comrade, you know, basically take me, get me out of this mess. Later on, after the battle, and I've brushed through this really quickly, but eventually the Americans and the Brits are able to crack the line. The Australians come in after the Americans leapfrog over them. The British come in after that. And then they start inspecting the tunnel and the area around there and realize that just how formidable this was. The tunnel itself had actually been constructed during Napoleon's time in the 1800s. Just a good example of what the Germans had captured and Americans showing off with their new German booty. A lot of this ending up back here in the United States. The first part of October, the Americans moved back to the front for a well rest. I should say one thing really important. Neither the 27th or the 30th Division got any reinforcements during the war. When they became entirely brigaded with the British and the Australians, Pershing basically forgot about them. and hence the title of my book, Borrowed Soldiers. Basically, he lent them to the British and the Australians, but you know what happens in your neighbors. You give them your rake and you never see it again. Well, that's what happened with these Americans. And Pershing never sent them any reinforcements. So those, you know, 20,000 or more troops were dwindled down by the battles. Eventually, they get called back into the line. The British feel they have the Germans on the run, and the next campaign takes place. It is the Sel River. And at this point, the Americans are becoming really more confident. They know what they're doing, and they're starting to make their own decisions. And a lot of this is kind of rear guard fighting. German troops are heading back back to the homeland, but they're not giving up, and they're fighting, and they're stopping, and you have these small action battles. 107th Infantry, which ends up taking more casualties than any other American regiment in the war, here at Saint-Souplet, near the Sel River. Eventually, by the middle of October, the Americans go back to the rear area for more training, get their uniforms back in shape, and basically to rest. Little did they know this was going to be the last time that they would ever be in line. And on November 11th, you have the armistice is called, and the 27th and 30th Division never go back to the fighting. The war ends, and basically they're sitting around just like every other American division, trying to figure out what to do, train some more, and basically keep out of trouble. One of the gruesome tasks of the war was to bury the dead. Burial parties were formed, led by chaplains. They would go out and they would identify where the casualties were based on witness reports. There were two dog tags given to each soldier at this time. When a casualty was found, one of the dog tags was hammered onto a wooden cross. The other was kept in a file, which are now all at the, at the National Archives. Eventually, the Americans would come home. Shipping was found for them. And great parades, this particular one in Washington Square in New York, welcoming the 27th. But you had similar things in Charleston, South Carolina for the 30th Division, Raleigh, North Carolina for the 30th, and Buffalo for more of the 27th Divisions. I mean, a lot of fanfare. Newspapers would print full editions talking about the troops and all their heroics. Those that did not make it back, there were choices made. American families were given a decision very unique in world history. And that was you could either keep your loved ones overseas in newly constructed cemeteries, or at government expense, the bodies could be repatriated back to the United States. And about roughly a third of the American families elected to have their loved ones remain behind. And these eventually were cemeteries that are now still run by the American Battle Monuments Commission. This is the Somme American Cemetery in Bonny, where many of the 27th and 30th lie. The French took great pride in the cemeteries and also saluting the efforts of the Americans. I've been over to the cemetery on more than one occasion, and one of the women who works there, her grandfather worked in the cemetery originally, and she would tell me how much pride they took in manicuring the lawn and just making sure everything was in perfect shape. I mean, they have their own grounds crew. Here in the United States and some of our military cemeteries, things are contracted out. Not over there. There's just a tremendous amount of pride. While the American troops were still overseas, surveys were done about their experience with the British and the French. And they would, each of the line officers and the commanding officers from like Reed and Simmons and Lewis and O'Ryan were queried about what their experiences were like with the British. And they were pretty honest. I mean, one of the things they complained about is understanding the British accent, knowing what the heck they were talking about. But by and large, they were very supportive. So jump forward to 1944. General Dwight D. Eisenhower is forming the Chafe, the Supreme Allied Expeditionary Force for the invasion of Europe. And he's going to be working alongside the British Field Marshal Montgomery. So he wants to know how to get along with the British. So he assigns one of his staff officers to go back and look at the First World War. So they looked at some of these same surveys, and they published papers to understand what it was going to be like with the British. And in summary, to end that abruptly, the relationship between the Americans and British, I think, it set its seeds in World War I. Even today, you know, we're overseas in Afghanistan and still in Iraq, and our closest ally still is the British and also the Australians. And few people, I think, know that relationship began in early training camps in 1917, but also in 1918. And as much complaining as the Americans did, I think they recognized that it was a unique experience serving with the British, and it was something that, even though I think a lot of them wouldn't want it to be with the Americans in the American sector and fighting in the Meuse Argonne, I think they enjoyed and they look back on their experience. So this is a quick trip through the story of the borrowed soldiers, and I don't know how much time there is, but I'll be glad to entertain any questions you might have. Yes, sir.
When the 27th and 30th were mentioned in dispatches, or when they were given awards, were they given British awards?
They were. One thing I forgot to point out, the 30th Division had more medals of honor than any other American division during the war, just because of the severe fighting that they did in leading the attack on the Hindenburg Line. But yeah, they were given British awards as well. And a lot of that was kind of honorary kind of things to support them. Yes, sir.
How many soldiers were lost on the way over?
On the way over?
Yeah, but were any of the ships torpedoed?
None of the ones carrying the 27th and 30th. I'm not aware of any casualties from British food either, so. Yes, sir. You had a question?
No, I'm afraid I was just stretching.
All right, well, that's good enough. In the back? The Canadians were also brigaded with them, and the Americans trained a little bit with them, but they never fought side by side in line. Yes, sir.
How did the logistics support for those two divisions work? Were they supported by Brits or Americans?
Eventually by Brits, and it was a huge thing that Simmons had to work out with the British as far as getting them their supplies. And actually, it worked out better in most cases than the Americans. As you know from the Meuse Argonne, things really bogged down halfway through, whereas the American troops with the British actually were better supplied because the Brits obviously had a lot longer time to prepare and had their supply lines down. Yes, sir.
I had a logistics question. They were issued Lee-Enfield rifles, correct?
Yes.
And the second thing is, in terms of replacements for their casualties, did Pershing not send replacements because of logistics that it was too difficult, or they wanted to keep them all the American replacements consolidated in Iran?
I think I've never seen anything definitively, but I guess just exactly what you said. I think that he considered, because the main body of the Americans were going to be fighting in the Argonne area, that's where he was going to send his reinforcements to. And I think he kind of just said, okay, well, they're with the British, so let the British worry about them. And it was kind of the attitude he had. Even if you look at his memoirs after the war, my experiences, he doesn't spend a whole lot of time talking about those two divisions.
My great uncles originally were Canadian and then moved to Cleveland. And one brother joined the Canadian Army and the other one joined the American Army. And supposedly they actually ran, the one that was in the American Army, I know it was in the service of supply. So he supposedly ran into his brother behind the lines in 1918.
Cool. Very good.
So we must have been sending some supplies up to those guys.
Well, I mean, I shouldn't say we were totally abandoning them, but I think we relied almost entirely on the British. Just like, okay, they're yours now. You take care of them, kind of attitude. Doug?
You said the divisions were roughly 27,000, 28,000 men.
Yeah.
What happened? How many casualties did they have? What percentage of their people did they lose since they weren't recent,
You bring up a good question. Both divisions didn't have their own artillery. They ended up serving with American First Army in the Argonne. So actually, in reality, once they started getting into line, they were down to about 18,000, and that was just mostly support troops, and then you had medical and signal corps coming over later on. Their attrition rate was about the same as other American divisions. I think by told, they lost, let me see, I have the number here, about, well, the 106, for example, lost 1,500 alone just in the Hindenburg Line operation. That's, you know, killed and wounded. But it was somewhere around 3,000 to 4,000 eventually died on from each division. So it's a significant a number. And, you know, there's a number of reasons why the casualties. The officer corps was not very good, and just a lot of mistakes were made. Another hand up.
You sort of answered my question. I was going to ask what happened with the DeVardi and all the other support troops that didn't go along with the frontline infantry and
the Eventually, yeah, the medical corps came over, and the both divisions had their own medical, although they shared British hospitals. And they used their own signal corps and a number of other auxiliary troops like service of supply kinds of things and military police and so forth.
But these were square divisions, four infantry regiments?
Yes. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.